Welcome to our service this morning.
Good morning.
Pastor Tim is out for this weekend, and for those of you who don't know me, my name is Donna Fancher. I'm the lay speaker here at our church, and I'm happy to be able to be with you today. And I thank you for coming, both those here and those at home. Let's just take a quick moment and look at the quiet meditation as printed in your bulletin. The author is unknown. I found this on the internet, and it just touched me, so I wanted to share it with you today. Someone, somewhere, is depending on you to do what God has called you to do. Think about that for a quick moment. Our actions ripple like a stone thrown to a pond, for good or for bad. But just stop and think that what you do today can affect other people that you don't even know, as that stone and those ripples go on.
Stand if you're able as you call each other to worship. Now is the time to worship. We gather today as people God calls to go and share the good news.
We gather as God's sent out people.
We gather to listen and share God's work in our lives, our families, and our neighborhoods.
We proclaim the goodness of God's love together.
We gather to respond to God's grace as we continue on a path of discipleship.
We hear God's call and learn to say yes to God together. Amen.
Please remain standing for our first hymn, Standing on the Promises, number 374 in the UN hymnal.
Thank you.
faithful in our service to you. Give us the patience and understanding to face life's challenges with grace. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Let us pray silently, confessing our faults and sins before God. Listen to our assurance of pardon. Even on a cross, Jesus cried out for forgiveness. We are worthy of forgiveness and love. We are called to share that love and forgiveness with others. Amen. Please stand if you're able for our next hymn, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus," number 21, 29, in the Faith We Sing.
Jesus. call you on the telephone?
No.
You think he'd send you a letter?
No.
You think he'd send you a text?
No.
But he might talk to you in your mind or your heart, right? And he might tell you to help your mommy or be kind to somebody else, right? So that's what we want to do when we hear inside us that God wants us to do something special. We should listen to that voice, right? Let us pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, please guide and bless these beautiful children. May they follow your call always. And may the big people here also follow God's call always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now today we have devil dogs. I thought something different would be nice. If you don't want it, you can give it back.
I'll have them up.
Okay. Yeah. Do you have one?
I don't
know. Oh.
I just
get
one.
Do you have
no
one?
One?
I can go down and give Mr. Pond one. Okay.
That's the only way
we're going
to turn.
Good job. Good job. We'll now let our chorus sing our choral anthem of God in Heaven.
Please listen for a word from God as we read from the Holy Scriptures. The scripture reading today is from the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 through 9. The Lord had said to Abram, "Go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarai, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan. And they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built an altar there to the Lord, who had appeared to him. From there he went on toward the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. Then Abram set out and continued toward the Negev.
Thank you.
remain standing for the reading of the gospel. The reading is from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 9, verses 9 through 13. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner in Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Where we might not want to go, or at least to places we aren't too sure about. There are too many unanswered questions in responding to a call, even a call that comes from the one we call Lord. Genesis is deeply focused on God's relationship with the nation of Israel. That relationship has its first official beginning in these verses. Scripture doesn't give us any information on whether Abram experienced some prior relationship with God, or even if he had previously communicated with the Lord. Abram's people, including his father Terah, worshipped false gods, as told to us in Joshua chapter 24, verse 2. From some research I did on this topic, Ur and Haran, Abram's former and current homes, were apparently centers of worship of the moon. Abram was 75 years old when he received his call from God. Abram was wealthy and had settled with his father's extended family in Haran. He was married to Sarai, but they were barren and childless. We're not told whether he was an especially good or bad man. As with many of the human instruments used by God, this is secondary. All that ultimately matters is that God intends to accomplish his will through this particular man and his family. Let's keep in mind, God shows up in Abram's life with very specific commands and some staggering promises. God's first word to Abram is go. God calls Abram to leave many things, his country, his father's household, his life there. He was to go to an unnamed land which God would show to him. Abram could not stay where he was and still obey God. He is being called to leave his old life, to commit himself to the Lord. In going, though, God has promised to do great things for Abram. So Abram sets out with his wife, Sarai, later known as Sarah, his nephew Lot, and the people they had acquired in Haran, as well as all the possessions they had accumulated. Remember, Abram was a rich man. God promises to bless Abram and to make his descendants into a great nation who will one day occupy the land of Canaan. Though childless and with no obvious path to becoming the father of an entire culture, Abram obeys God's command and goes to the land of Canaan. Through Abram's family tree, eventually, Jesus Christ will be born with the object of saving humanity. Abram's first steps in following God led to the gift of eternal life for you and for me. Genesis chapter 12 contains a key moment in the history of the world. God chooses Abram as the first step in building his people Israel, and Abram obeys God's call. A little background on Abram. God called Abram to be the beginning, the genesis, of a new nation. A huge task. Now, just to clarify, Abram actually gets a change of name later on in Scripture to Abraham, which is the name we know him by today. Abraham is an important figure in Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. He's known as the first Hebrew and was an ancestor to all Israelites. He was also one of the first people to practice monotheism, which is the belief that there is only one deity, usually known as God. At the time of his call from God, Abram had a choice to make. Should he set out for parts unknown or stay where he was? He had to decide between the security of what he already had and the uncertainty of traveling under God's direction. All he had to go on was God's promise to guide and bless him. This decision to follow God set in motion the development of the nation that God would eventually use as his own when he visited earth itself in the form of Jesus Christ. Think for just a moment. Receiving a message such as this from God, to simply go. God tells Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you. Keep in mind, Abram didn't have a GPS. He didn't have a map. He didn't have a phone to Google information on. I'm sure Abram would have had questions, at least in his head and heart, even if he was afraid to ask God directly. But what we do know is his action. Abram went. That's it. He listened and he went. He answered the call. Now, a point of interest to this narrative, God didn't want Abram to wait on this request. He wanted action right away. Just think for a moment. What if God talked to you directly and told you to pack up and go to Central America or Canada immediately? Think about that for a moment, leaving everything you've ever known. It makes me wonder, what was the call of God to Abram like? From today's scripture, it doesn't sound like it was from a burning bush like Moses would one day experience. It doesn't sound like it was a gentle whisper like the kind Elijah would hear. Was it a loud roar? Did it come to him in a storm? Did the call come to him in a dream? Or did it come to him in a feeling in his mind and heart that God needed him to do this important task? We'll never actually know how the call from God came to Abram, but it makes us wonder, how would a call to us come from God? Now there's some food for thought. Now let's take a look at our gospel lesson today. Matthew is sitting at his tax collector's table collecting the taxes as Jesus walks by. A little history lesson on tax collecting during this time. Judea, as a Roman province, was under the protection of Rome and enjoyed privileges such as economic trade and relatively safe passage throughout Rome's vast empire. The privileges or peace of Rome came with a price. The Jews had to endure the humiliation of being ruled by despised Gentiles. They had to tolerate their offensive pagan worship and practices, which threatened to undermine the Jewish way of life. The Jews also had to submit to Roman laws and customs. This included paying taxes to Rome, a practice that was particularly unpopular. Rome would hire local people to collect taxes for its imperial budget. It had the potential to be a lucrative office for the one who held it. Tax collectors had the power to determine what people owed the empire, and there were no fair courts to appeal any discrepancies. Tax collectors were expected to overcollect and retain a commission to serve as their pay. However, they were notorious for overcharging beyond what was expected. They taxed their neighbors at unbelievably high rates, keeping the excess for themselves. Now, Matthew was one of those despised tax collectors. He belonged to this group of those considered to be sinners and traitors. But when Jesus saw Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth, Jesus called out to him, "Follow me." This was similar to what Jesus told Andrew and Peter when he called them to be his disciples, as told to us in Matthew chapter 4. And get this, Matthew gets up, leaving a lucrative career, and follows Jesus. After being called, it did his help. As a tax collector for the Romans, Matthew presumably had a poor reputation among Jews. The scripture from Matthew indicates other sinners were also dining there that night, plus Jesus attended dinner as well. Now understand that tax collectors would be presumed sinners by the religious establishment. This was too scandalous for the Pharisees, who were highly respected leaders, defenders of the Jewish faith, and teachers at the local synagogues. When the Pharisees saw this, they expressed their disapproval to Jesus' disciples. Matthew does not tell us why the Pharisees said what they did to the disciples instead of directly to Jesus. Perhaps they thought it effective to undermine Jesus by sowing doubt and projecting shame among his disciples instead of confronting him outright. The disciples might have been having second thoughts about the effect on their own reputation after letting a tax collector join their ranks. The Pharisees asked the disciples, "Why is your teacher eating with the tax collectors and sinners?" The unmistakable implication was, if your teacher was holy and righteous, he would not be publicly associated with such vile people. When Jesus heard what the Pharisees were saying to his disciples about him, he responded with a short parable. It is not those who are healthy who need a physician, but those who are sick. Now we know physicians offer treatment for the purpose of bodily healing. In most cases, it is those who are sick who seek the help of medical doctors. On its most basic level, Jesus is like a spiritual physician who heals wicked hearts, corrupt minds, and lives ravaged by the disease of sin. Of course, we see many instances of Jesus healing people from various illnesses and demons, so he is also a physical physician. From this scripture, we understand that those who are sick are the spiritually unhealthy tax collectors and sinners. Their sin is very plain to see. They are those with whom Jesus was dining with that evening. They are those who are clearly in need of Jesus' spiritual help. The Pharisees, of course, believe they are healthy. So Jesus' argument is quite logical. I am with people you acknowledge need spiritual healing because I am a spiritual physician. But in truth, Jesus is found eating with the tax collectors and sinners because he has a deliberate mission of spiritual healing. Looking at this from Jesus' viewpoint, everyone is sick, including the self-righteous Pharisees. The Pharisees keep the law externally, but internally, they violate the law. They are sinners too. They're also sick. It's just that their sickness is not as apparent. Jesus will reveal the Pharisees' sins later in Matthew, particularly in chapter 23, when he makes their motives publicly known when he states, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites." In both of these cases from Scripture today, God and Jesus chose ordinary people to accomplish extraordinary tasks. As mentioned at the beginning of my sermon, both our Scripture reading and our Gospel reading today deal with one topic, heeding the call of our Lord God. Both Abram and Matthew heeded this call in spades. They were called and they answered that call. To be blunt, God and or Jesus may call on any of us to do a task for them as well. In fact, I would be willing to bet that many of you have followed God's calls in numerous ways throughout your lives. But the idea of being called is rather daunting. I'd like to share with you something that happened to me when my children were very young, which I believe to be actions spurred on by hunches in my mind, put there by God. It wasn't specifically a call, but I believe it truly came from God. My husband's grandmother was in her mid-80s, and we had not seen her for quite some time. She lived down at the Jersey Shore, which was a rather long trip. Both my husband and I worked jobs outside the home during the week, so weekends were always very busy with chores and doing activities with our sons. I kept having this feeling that we should go visit Nana. This feeling was very strong, and I mentioned it to my husband on several occasions. The response I got was, "We just don't have time right now," or, "We'll get to it later on once we get caught up on things. You know the drill." Well, this intense feeling, and by then it was intense, kept coming to me in my mind. Go visit Nana. So I pushed and pushed. Yes, I nagged. And we finally went for that visit. Nana was so delighted to have us. She hugged and kissed the boys over and over and was just thrilled with the visit. As we left her house late that afternoon to drive back home, I glanced back and she had a sad look on her face, although she was waving goodbye. 2 weeks later, she passed away. I am so thankful I pushed my husband to take that trip, but we did. Otherwise, we would never have seen Nana, and she would never have seen us again. I truly believe in my heart that it was God who kept pushing me to make this visit while it was still possible. Hearing a call from God may be as simple as a push towards calling a sick friend, going to visit someone in the hospital, preparing a meal for someone in need, sending a cheer-up card to someone you know who has been down in the dumps. The call could be for something small or for something much larger. When God calls us to follow a certain course, and make no mistake, I believe God has a purpose for each of us. How will you respond? Will you answer as quickly and as surely as Abram or Matthew? I know that when Pastor Jane asked me if I'd be interested in becoming a lay speaker 15 years ago, I was shocked. Me? Are you kidding? But 15 years after taking the first lay speaking course, I'm still here today. And let me tell you, it was not an easy decision. This initially was completely out of my comfort zone. If it hadn't been for that little voice inside me saying, do it, I doubt I would have done it. From today's bridal readings, we learned God called and Abraham listened. God called and Matthew answered. Throughout the Bible, others have answered God's calls as well. God called and Moses answered. God called and Noah answered. God called and Mary answered. May each of us take up the mantle of answering God's call when he gives it. Remember, it's not just clergy who get this call. It's the regular guys and girls too. Be ready for it and answer God with a resounding, "Here I am, Lord." Amen. It's now that time we talk about sharing our celebrations and concerns. And I have a couple up here. We're asking for continued prayers for Bobby, Jesse, Brandon, Molly, Charlene, Pastor Tim and family, Mary Claire and family. celebration. Lynn Kroll's daughter, Lori DeGraw, got engaged on Friday. Another prayer of concern for Mike on the passing of his son. Mike's son passed away in a tragic car accident in Texas. A semi-truck crossed the highway and struck the son and his new wife. The wife survived, but the son did not. Mike is a friend of Pastor Tim's travel agent, and they requested prayers. Do we have other joys and concerns for today? Anna.
Lou, continue prayers for Lou and prayers for Pastor Tim's return home.
Okay, any other?
For Carol, Lynn, Susan, and Al.
Madison and Bree will be graduating high school Friday.
And I'd like to add Ellie Pariso. Ellie would have been here today. She had planned to be, but she developed a cough and a little scratchy throat, so she thought she should wait. So she's looking forward to coming back next Sunday. Let us bow our heads and pray. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, thank you for guiding us safely to church today as your church family. We thank you for those who are here. We pray for those who weren't able to make it today. Dear Lord, we thank you for being in our lives, for guiding us, for blessing us, for healing us. And we pray that we may always answer your call. Dear Lord, today we lift up in prayer for Mike on the passing of his son, as his son was killed in a tragic car accident. We pray for continued prayers for Bobby, Jesse, Brandon, Molly, Charlene, Pastor Tim and his family, Mary Claire and her family. We pray for Lou Cicchini. Pray he will be back with us soon. We pray for Pastor Tim's safe return home. We pray for Carol, Lynn, Susan, and Al. We pray for Betty Martin, who has a heart issue. We pray for Ellie Pariso and pray she can come back to church with us next weekend. But with the concerns, dear Lord, we also have joys. We have Lori DeGraw, who was engaged on Friday. May she and her fiancé be very, very happy. We pray for Madison and Bree, who graduate from high school on Friday, and for Steve, who's also graduating high school. And we wish them well in their future endeavors. Dear Lord, again, we thank you for being with us each and every day of our lives. As we pray the words that Jesus himself taught us in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. offer to God our gifts so that we can do future community and church activities. Our ushers will wait on you. Today, crown him with many crowns. Be found in the hymnal book on page 327.
Thank you.
I wish each and every one of you a good and safe week. As you leave this gathering, hear God's call to go. Go into the uncertainty of the journey ahead, trusting that of this you can be certain. God is with us, and we are sent out together. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Amen.